We're going to get into some stuff that's really just absolutely amazing. But, you know, last week we read in Acts chapter 7, and I didn't get to finish it. But, and I've been talking all week to John about it, you know. Just, man, when God starts revealing things to you, it's like, you know, it's really amazing. It's by no coincidence that Charlene wanted to play that song, "We Shall Behold Him Face to Face." Because we're going to find out what the ultimate goal of the Holy Spirit is. What is His purpose? You know, what did He come for? And, you know, Jason sang the song, "For I Live Only to See Your Face." You know? And we can look where we're reading at in Acts chapter 7 when Stephen is being stoned, that Stephen actually, the Bible says that the heavens open up and Jesus stands up on the right side of the throne, and Stephen out loud says, through the Holy Spirit, and we're going to read it where he says it, "And by the power of the Holy Spirit," or the Holy Ghost that was upon Stephen, "he said, I see the Lord standing on side of the throne." You're going to realize and find out that the power of the Holy Spirit is the ability. He came to give you the ability to not only be able to preach the gospel, which we'll get into that, but it's the ability so that you and me can actually see the face of Jesus and be able to show it to others. Then he sang a song, the next song that Jason sang, you know, "And I fall face down as your glory shines around." And we learned that the glory of God is, we beheld the glory of God in 1 John in the face of Christ. You know, I think there's a big misconception about who the Holy Spirit is, what He's come to do. You know, do we have the ability to, you know, do we use Him? You know, what do you really think about? What was His whole purpose in coming? You know, when the Comforter comes, and we're gonna get into that. I'm going to show you what not the sole purpose of the Holy Spirit is, or the Holy Ghost, but it's ultimately, you know, to reveal the face of Jesus. And you're going to find out so that it can make you a witness for Him. We're going to go through the scriptures, you know, not taking things out of context, but you're going to see that every time that the apostles and the disciples, you know, they are the apostles, whenever they preached the gospel, they always went back to the old covenant, so that they can reveal who Jesus was. And that's what your job is, to be able to make you a witness, a testimony to who He is. And when you see these scriptures, how they're portrayed and how they fall out, that every time, every single time, you see the disciples or the apostles stand up, the first thing they, you know, and I know I talk about this, the first thing they do is they go back and they connect the old covenant to the new covenant. Because you got to have two witnesses. Let everything be established by two or three witnesses. So the old covenant is a witness. Jesus said, "For it speaks of me," right? The new covenant is a witness, right? Two or three witnesses. And by you studying the word, you become a witness or a testimony to who Jesus Christ is. I'm going to show you things today that is like, wow. I mean, just like mind-blowing. Little things that we read over and we miss. You know, you think about, here's one I'll just throw at you real quick, that we read the Bible. Why did Jesus come with signs and miracles? You know, why did He do signs and miracles? Well, if you realize that Jesus was the fulfillment of the Passover, right? Why did signs accompany His ministry? Because He said, if you don't believe me, believe for the miracle's sake, the signs and the wonders that you're seeing. The Feast of Passover is actually called the Feast of Freedom. And it represents when the children of Israel was coming out of bondage and slavery out of Egypt. And God delivered them through signs and wonders. Wow. So if the feast of Passover, which began in Egypt, was accompanied by signs and wonders, is what set them free, remember, through the last sign, which was the death of the firstborn. Jesus fulfills this being the Lamb of God, but he's also got to fulfill the signs and wonders part. So just like he's telling them, and we're going to read it, look, you know, in Acts chapter 7, when they were leaving Egypt, signs and wonders occurred. So this was something that they was accustomed to. Here Jesus comes doing the same thing. You know, walking on water, you know, healing the sick, raising the dead, all these signs and wonders. And Moses had prophesied that when this prophet comes, him shall ye hear. That's the one you need to believe. What I want to get across to you is, and I drill you all the time with having to know your word. You know, and I tell you, you need to read. You need to read. Because, you know, but now I want to show you why you need to read. By reading the word, you'll actually become a witness and a testimony for Jesus Christ. That's what you're supposed to be. If you don't have the Word of God in you, well then your ability to be like Apollos did, it says that in mightily through the Scriptures, he convinced them that Jesus was the Christ. Jesus revealed to the two disciples, apostles or disciples, that was walking on the road of Emmaus, who he was through Moses, Psalms, and the prophets. And then he disappeared. And they said, didn't our hearts burn and yearn inside of us when we heard his voice? But how did he prove that Jesus was the Christ? It's easily, what if somebody came to you today, you that's been following Jesus for maybe 10, 15, 20 years and said, man, why do you follow Jesus? Well, because, man, he died for my sins. He's the Savior of the world. Oh, yeah? Prove it to me. Show me. Oh, so you take him. Open up, you know, in the Gospels, you see right here, Jesus, he died and he rose again. Okay, so what makes you believe that? Well, brother, you just got to have faith. And let me tell you, that's where we fall out.
Yeah.
Because we can only take people to the cross, which is good. But to an unsaved and unbelieving world, if you can take them back, like all the apostles did, who were unlearned and unskilled in the word.
Right.
In fact, I told you last week, when they chose seven deacons, remember?
Right.
That Peter said, it's not right for us to be, you know, to feed at tables, to serve at tables. We need to be given our time to the Scriptures.
Right.
Right?
Right.
Right.
And that's why it's important, so that you can become a witness and a testimony for Jesus Christ. And I'm going to tell you, in the modern church today, not speaking against no churches. I mean, there's only one body, one church. But as a whole, in the West and where we live at, the church has actually been taught wrong. In a sense of, I remember my mom used to do flashcard memorization to me when I was a kid.
Mm-hmm.
You know, and that's good, studying the Scriptures. That's fine. But I wasn't taught how important the letter was. I wasn't taught about the context of it. What was going on? I never did get it like that. And I thought it was just Bible stories.
Yeah.
you know, I heard about Noah and I heard about David killing Goliath, and that's all I ever, you know, that's what I heard. Just taught the word. I was in church. I was in Sunday school. Heard the stories, but never was brought below the surface. I was always shown Jesus. He was the Savior to forgive you of your sins. And if you believe it, well, then you're saved, and that's it. But there's a purpose why you have the Word of God sitting in front of you, which we also neglect to read. And that is, listen, the power of the Holy Ghost that was to come. When the Holy Spirit came, He would endue you with power to be able to testify of what the Scriptures is saying, and to prove beyond the shadow of a doubt that Jesus is the Christ.
Amen.
Do you have the ability within you to be able to do that? Let me tell you something. If you're one that reads your word, the Spirit will bring to your remembrance what it is that you need to say in the time that God begins to walk you through. He'll begin to show you. You don't need to, you know, everybody's not going to, it says some 100-fold, some 60-fold, and some 30-fold will bring into the kingdom. We all will bring in 100-fold. Now, 100 is just like a 100 is a fold, right? It folds over.
Mm-hmm.
It's more than 100.
Because mm-hmm.
when you take a $100 bill and you fold it over and you look at it, one that's 200, right? It's folded.
Yeah.
John was just, you know, telling me about that. He folded up one for me here recently. But listen, you know, my whole purpose is, number one, to blow your doors off.
That's okay.
You know, but to take you deeper.
Yes.
To make you a student and a disciple of God's Word so that, you know, you can begin to read, whether it's in Ephesians, just like we started in Acts, and be able to understand what Paul's talking about in the church of Ephesus, why he's saying it, what he's talking about, you know, so that if someone asks you, I remember I used to sit down with John and Cherie when I told him to first start reading in John, and he started reading. I know people who read. They call me. They text me. They send me things. And he says, "What?" And John would tell me, "What is he talking about here?" And then I would begin to explain to him, because it's time spent in the Word. Because remember, you are to be just like all the so great a cloud of witnesses that was before us. You're a witness to the death, burial, and resurrection of Jesus Christ. That's why in ministry, we have a brother that's in here, and I'm going to let him, he doesn't even know it, I'm going to let him tell you what I'm talking about. This is a brother that we went out and ministered to, and I want to see what caught him. Okay? Pierre, stand up. I want you to, now listen, I'm gonna tell you what happens. Usually when I go out and I minister, you know, people are absolutely blown away by the things that I teach, that I was taught by the Holy Spirit. I mean, and you guys know, you've been sitting under me a long time.
Yeah.
Whether I go to a prison or another church, they're like, "Oh my God, we've never heard anything like this in our life." I have, and listen, this is someone that I didn't minister to. This is someone that I poured into my brother, and my brother being with me learned, right? And then God developed him in his own skills as far as praise and worship. And now my brother and Pete, they go to the prison and they minister. This is a brother right here. I want to, and I haven't talked to him. I want to know I want to know what caught you to bring you to this church.
Well, first of all, it was music. When the gentlemen come up there, they mainly open up as they did here, and I'm a player. I like to play music. I love to play for the Lord. And that first drew my attention. Other than just getting out of the back room, which was really rough, but it came directly next to the Holy Spirit. The Holy Spirit just automatically revealed that these gentlemen knew the Word, they had been in the Word, they were able to automatically come out with whatever answer you had or knew how to find it, and it was educational, explanatory, and thorough. I like being precise. I'm European, I've got a lot of German blood in me, and I want things spot on. And when I sit there and I can talk to a man, and I've been in the Word 16 years, not very strong, but I'm just scratching the surface, but with the revelations that are given to them through the knowledge of the Word, it is passed on. And that's what caught me. I would have turned around and walked. You wouldn't have seen me again.
Okay, so tell me, what did you expect when, you know, this minister and this minister came in, or any other minister would come in? What was you expecting to hear out of them?
I was expecting to hear the same old rudimentary, you need to find God, this is how you get saved, and I understand that being their mission, that's what normally happens, but not in this case. It was driven. It was anointed by God to explain to folks that, you know, there's actually a way to do this, not just get fire insurance, you know. And there was a constant same group of guys that kept coming back. Campbell, that other
right.
And they're the ones that kept on staying in because they found wisdom and knowledge and understanding. And it only comes from the Holy Spirit. I know that.
Now, and thank you, brother. I appreciate it. Listen what he's saying.
Mm-hmm.
Listen what he's saying. He came in expecting one thing, but got totally the opposite of what he was actually expecting. And he said it was through the power of the Holy Spirit, through revelation and knowledge. The power of the Holy Spirit through revelation and knowledge. Number one, he felt the Spirit in worship. Right? Number two, when they spoke, when Jason spoke, he spoke with authority.
Yes.
Right.
You know what authority is? The ability to be able to interpret the Word with pinpoint accuracy. To be able to prove beyond the shadow of a doubt that Jesus is who he says he is. That's the power. This is what the disciples that Jesus told them, go wait and tarry till you be endued with the ability to be able to take the scriptures and to prove to others beyond the shadow of a doubt that I am who I say I am.
Amen.
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 And the gifts that the Spirit bring are only the working of the Holy Spirit to be able to prove and show others that Jesus is who he says he is.
Yeah.
And there's many gifts. Gifts of music. Gifts of helps. Gifts. There's all kinds of gifts that flow. But it's all to, you know, grow the body of Christ into maturity. And the body of Christ is missing the maturity.
Yes.
Amen. You're right about
because
that.
Of the milk, because of, number one, it'll start with the preachers and the pulpits. And number two, you have to, a disciple is a disciplined learner.
That's right.
A learner for what? So that you can show yourself approved. Unto who? 2 Timothy. Unto God. a workman. Young Timothy, study the scriptures. Young church, study the scriptures that are able to make you wise unto salvation. Study. Why? To show yourself approved.
Amen.
Unto who? Not Tony. Unto God.
Amen.
So that you can become a powerful witness and a testimony that Jesus Christ is who he says he is. I don't tell you to read so that it'll benefit you. I tell you to read so that it'll benefit others.
Amen.
Because you have to be ready to give an answer to someone, like Peter said. They were there to answer him right steadily when he gave the questions. Peter knew that he was a student of the Word. And that's what you've been called to be, a student of the Word. So that you can convince others. Apollos convinced others mightily through the scriptures. How? Because of his faith? Well, his faith in Jesus Christ won, but how can you convince somebody? Oh, I just have faith. That is not convincing to the world. If you have the ability to be able to go, you're going to tell me that the God who created this universe, set the sun, moon, earth, and stars, and everything. If we was closer to the sun, we'd burn up further away. Do you think that that just happened by coincidence? What you doing? You're taking them back to creation. Do you really believe in Darwinism? Do you really believe? The Bible says that God created man after his own image and likeness and pulled out a woman. You're going back to creation. Well, that ain't what, you know, the colleges are teaching us. Oh, so you believe that an amoeba crawled out of mud and, you know, as a fish came up on land, grew out the mud, came into an ape, and then came into where we at right now. You believe that. That's what the majority believe. But then also, to believe that, a female amoeba has got to crawl out the mud as well and do the exact same thing, and then those two amoebas are got to be able to have the ability to procreate and make life. That's a far stretch, son.
Yes, it is.
If there's a creation, there's a creator. But wait, it don't stop there. Then you have to believe that every species of animals, every insect, every bug that crawled out of the mud, crawled out male and female, and then had the ability to be able to procreate. Oh, my God. Oh, my God. There's no possible way. That's what's being taught. That's what our college students are being taught and learned, and our children that are in schools. It's much easier. Don't you believe it's much easier that there was a creator? If there's a creation, that's a creator that created you and me. Just get the average smart person to start thinking about that. So you're telling me every spider and every lizard and every bug and every doodle bug and every butterfly and every elephant, tiger, lion, and you go, they all crawled out the mud. And they crawled out identical to one another with opposite parts and then was able to mate and make many different things, you know, of their own species. The ability to know your word, to be able to convince others, not only to convince others, but to be able to take others deeper, to not be able to just stop at the door. The power of the Holy Ghost. We think the power of the Holy Ghost is speaking in tongues, when that was just a manifestation of his coming. When the power of the Holy Ghost really doesn't have anything to do with tongues, although it does in a sense, in that they spoke in other tongues so that they could preach the gospel to the many different languages that was around. The sign of the Holy Spirit coming was the rushing mighty wind.
Yeah.
because that wind is the Ruach HaKodesh, which is the breath of God, which shows up in creation, right? And the Spirit of God hovered over the waters and separated the waters from the waters. Where did that happen? That happened in Egypt. And a strong east wind, the Ruach HaKodesh, the breath of God, blew all night and separated the waters. When you start talking like this to people, you got their attention. Because it isn't by, it's not by might, nor by power, but by my Spirit. To do what? To interpret the Word of God.
Amen.
With power and authority. Amen. That's why they could not mess with Jesus.
Amen.
Because they would throw a scripture at him and he would reverse it right back on them. And the lawyers, the scribes and the Pharisees, the ones that were so trained in the law that jaws just dropped. And it says, and they dared not ask him any questions anymore. Right. They were scared.
That's right.
Ah! Son! That's power.
Yes.
That's why I get crazy and fired up.
Mm-hmm.
I saw his face.
Mm-hmm.
Ooh, my Lord, son.
Mm-hmm.
The power to be able to go into a prison or to be able to go somewhere. Someone who maybe had, you know, was taught the Word of God or been in the Word when they was young. Here it is, a man expecting to hear something he already heard before. Just all of a sudden, he starts peeling back the layers. Whoa. What? What? Ain't heard that one before. Wow. But you know what happens? When you hear it, instantly, it hits you in your spirit. It's like, oh my God, son, it's true. And then it's like, feed me.
Amen.
Because you don't know how starving you really are until you've ate something that's good. And every time you say it, God, it never ever loses its power.
Amen.
Never. I get as crazy now as I did 15 years ago when God began to reveal himself to me. No matter what it is, the Word of God does not lose its power.
Yeah.
In fact, it only intensifies.
Yes. Yeah.
About how awesome he is.
Amen.
If you get it in you. If you get it in you, the Word of God is a seed planted in you. The Spirit will cause it to grow. What did you say?
Amen.
Well, he's the water.
Amen.
Hey, I'm crazy, yeah.
So
I'm glad you guys are here. But the Word, the Spirit will cause that to grow. And guess what? You know, is it going to talk about himself? It's going to do one thing. The Spirit of God's going to do one thing. He's going to show you Jesus.
Yes.
And his whole goal, Jesus said, for the Father in John 14, I must go so that he... Now, wow, we've taken that Spirit concept to all kinds of levels. When the Spirit of God comes, he, so the Spirit is a he. But wait, hold up a second. He not only came as a he, but he also came as a dove. And he also came as fire.
Right.
Yes.
He also came as the wind.
Yes.
Son, he showed up on Aaron's rod as fruit. Wow. In every bit of it, every way he showed up, every time he shows up, He's just here to do one thing. He's here to show you Jesus.
Amen.
Because if you can see Jesus the Christ, that's what the job is to do, to reveal to you Jesus the Christ, not Jesus the man, your life will be changed. But then you will become like little children so that you can be taught, so that you now can teach.
Amen.
I'm going to show you every time, I'm going to show you the purpose of the Holy Spirit beyond the shadow of a doubt what He's come to do. You can't command Him. You can't tell Him. The only thing you can do is pray to the Father in Jesus' name.
Amen.
And if it's the Father's will, He will send His Spirit.
Amen.
You can't direct Him. You can't control Him. And if you think you got control of the Spirit, well, He shows up in fire and wind. Mm. Would anybody like to stand up and show me some wind and fire right now? Tell the Spirit to manifest. Well, so you don't control the Spirit then. The Spirit controls you. If you allow Him to.
Yes.
And He will use you to show forth His Son. And I'm going to tell you something. Anytime you start talking about Jesus, the Spirit comes close. And then He gets on you. And then all of a sudden, He starts using you. Why? Because you're magnifying one. And that one is Jesus Christ.
Amen.
It's not uplifting you. It's not about me coming out dressed up in white. It's not about me showboating such and such is coming here or there. In fact, it'd probably be best if preachers were behind a veil.
That's right.
And all you heard was the voice.
That's right.
Amen.
Think about it. You didn't see God. And a voice from heaven said, "This is my beloved Son." But wait, hold on a second. Remember, the Holy Spirit's job is to be the identifier of who Jesus the Christ is.
That's right.
Oh, so let's just look at that one. So Jesus come to John, right? John, being full of the Holy Ghost, says, "There's the Lamb."
Right.
Wait, hold on a second. So the Holy Ghost's job is to identify the Lamb of God that takes away the sins of the world.
Amen.
Hey, that's just one right there, right? So now, John says, "There's the Lamb of God that takes away the sins of the world." So John, through the power, and it's read just like that, through the power of the Holy Ghost, says, "There is the Lamb of God." He identifies from the Old Covenant through Egypt the Lamb that takes away the sins of the world on the Feast of Freedom, which is the Feast of Release, which, remember, that was released from Egypt. Now Jesus, after being identified by John, John was a witness and a testimony, Jesus said, that they, while they walked in His light, they loved it. Now Jesus shows up. Now the Holy Spirit, or the Holy Ghost, descends on Him like a dove. So now, the Holy Spirit, in the form or the shape of a dove, He's the identifier of who Jesus is. The Spirit comes down and rests on top of Him.
Okay.
The Spirit's job is to identify who the Christ, who Jesus Christ is, and a voice from heaven says, "This is my Son."
Oh, hallelujah.
The Spirit descended, the voice says, "This is the one." Who identifies Him? The Spirit identifies who He is, and God said, "This is my Son." So let's make it plain and simple what the Holy Spirit or the Holy Ghost's job is to do: to reveal Jesus Christ and to empower you to become a witness of that.
Hallelujah.
Through the Scriptures and your testimony. Remember in Revelations? Right? That's right. Wait, hold on a second. Let's talk about Revelation. What is the book of Revelation? The book of Revelation is the book of revealing or unveiling.
That's right.
Amen.
Revealing or unveiling what? Jesus Christ.
That's right. Hallelujah.
Wow. How was that manifested? How was that done? And John was in the Spirit.
That's right.
On the Lord's Day. That's when he's coming.
Mm-hmm.
When he's coming, he's showing his face. For I was in the Spirit on the Lord's day when he received a revelation, an unveiling, a removing of the mask. And what does John do first? He describes what he looks like.
Right. Write it down.
Hallelujah.
Shows him his face. And his girts were girded. He had a golden girdle and his robe was down and his feet were bronze and a sword came out and fire in his eyes. Through the Spirit, John, the Revelator, is revealing who Jesus is. That's what he's supposed to do. Now, you say you have that revelation. Can you reveal it to others? You got it. The Spirit revealed to you. And we received that salvation. Now, God has called you to have the ability, whether in season or out of season, to preach the Word. Right? Preach the Word. Let's look at some scriptures. Check this out. It says, go to Acts 7. I want to tell you, this Wednesday, I'm going to start the feast. I'm going to get into the feast and the festivals of the Lord. The feast and the festivals, the spring feast and fall feast, were given to us, I told you guys, so that it can reveal the first and second coming of the Lord. That's what they're there for. That's why Israel was commanded to keep the spring feast, Passover, unleavened bread, first fruits, and Pentecost. And the fall feast, Rosh Hashanah, Yom Kippur, and the Feast of Tabernacles. Why? Because it all pointed to the Messiah to come. But it also points to his second coming.
Mm-hmm.
So if you want to be in a darkness as to what's coming, well then, don't read. The Bible says that when the Spirit will come, his job is not only he will teach you all things about Jesus, but he will reveal to you things to come. And that's what happened with John. John was in the Spirit. Holy Spirit came over him and revealed, gave him revelation of things to come. So God will come and reveal unto us that, you know, the world is doing their thing right now, but we see the signs that are out there. Things are, man, wow, are just being intensified on a massive level right now. I don't want you to study your Bible so that you can learn more. Because it's not about you learning more for you. Because it's not about you. And it's not about me. The reason we study is so that we can show and tell God, your word is important to me. What's important to you is important to me. And I know you love people. God, the only thing that you can give to the Father is others. That's it. There's only one thing that you could take to heaven with you. And that's a lost soul that you minister to through the power of the Holy Spirit. And some will bring in 30. Some will bring in 60. and some will bring in 100-fold. So getting into the spirit, you know, some people say all kind of crazy things about the spirit, what he's here for, what he's been called to do, and they separate themselves in these different categories and stuff like that. But ultimately, there are gifts that follow the spirit that enable us to do what it is that God has called us to do. If God has called you to do something, well, believe me, the spirit knows what it is that God has called you to do, and he will equip you for it. Whatever it is, whether it's to walk a walk that you didn't choose to walk through, like my wife. Wow. My wife could have kicked me to the side a long time ago. My own family told her, you need to get rid of him. Her own family said, if you go back with him, you'll never be welcome in this house again. But she received a word from the Lord. If you're faithful, I will bring him back again, says the Lord. Wow. The Spirit of the Lord gives us whatever it is that we need to accomplish his will. Acts chapter 4. The church was in great persecution. And the disciples prayed for the new believers that were there. Right? And it says, they prayed out, Lord, I like how it says it. You go back and read it. These guys that were praying were already under the power. Because of the persecutions that was going on and the things that was happening, we might think about some things that are coming and like, oh my God, look, don't worry about it. Because the Holy Spirit's job is to give us what we need and the time that we need it. And I'm going to read in Acts chapter 4. Flip back to Acts chapter 4. Watch this. The disciples. Now, persecution had come through the church. Look what he says. This is in Acts chapter 4. The apostles' prayer for boldness. It says in verse 23, and being let go, they went to their own company. That it was just in prison, right? And being let go, they were told not to speak the name of Jesus anymore. And being let go, they went to their own company and reported all that the chief priests and elders had said to them. And when they heard that, the ones that was there, they lifted up their voice to God with one accord and said, Lord, thou art God, which has made heaven and earth and the sea and all that is in them. Wow. They're confessing who God is through creation. Who, by the mouth of thy servant David, Old Covenant, hath said, what? This is Psalms 2 right here. Why did the heathen rage and the people imagine vain things? The kings of the earth stood up and the rulers were gathered together against the Lord and against his Christ. That word Lord right there is Yahweh, against God and the Christ. That's the anointed one, the Messiah. For of a truth, against thy holy child Jesus, whom thou hast anointed, both Herod and Pontius Pilate, with the Gentiles, and the people of Israel were gathered together. This is a fulfillment of Psalms 2. That's what he's testifying to. For to do whatsoever thy hand and thy counsel determined before to be done. And now, Lord, behold their threatenings, and grant unto thy servants that with all boldness they may speak thy word.
Amen.
Now, it's amazing here, because the prayer that they're praying, they just come out of prison. They just testified and said prior to this, okay, they're being put in prison for testifying of Jesus Christ. After they whipped them and scourged them, they said, now, go out and speak. Go out and talk of Jesus no more. Now, you know what they say? They're already filled up with the Holy Ghost, son.
Right.
Yep.
They said, is it better for me to listen to you or to God? So they already got the power, son. They already full with boldness. They done scourged them. And they told them, if you do this again, we're going to scourge you again. Okay. Okay. Is it better for me to listen to you or God?
That's right.
Well, he just told them, I'm not listening to you. I'm going to preach Jesus. And they turned them loose. So when they get to where they're at, to the disciples that are there, that are hiding and are scared,
amen,
they pray to God that boldness will come upon them.
Amen.
So that they too can be a witness and a testimony, whether they threaten to kill you or not. And how did the Holy Spirit, show up there? Well, I'll tell you, the same way he did in the upper room. And the whole house shook violently. I'm sorry, Pete.
My rig, I just hit on that.
The whole house shook violently. What shakes a house violently?
Wind.
There he is again. There he is, the wind. Now, if you go to your Bible and you look up in your Hebrew Strong's Concordance, you'll see wind there is the word Ruach HaKodesh in the Greek. It's the Spirit of God.
There it is.
Thank you very much. It's in the Jewish Bible, right? The Hallelujah Scriptures. It says, what does it say?
It says, and when they had prayed, the place where they came together was shaken. They were all filled with the Ruach HaKodesh.
Thank you very much.
Spoke the word of Yahweh with boldness.
Oh, they didn't speak in tongues though.
Oh
my God, what happened there? They didn't have to speak in tongues.
Amen.
Because there was there was devout men out of all the different nations. It says, wait, I missed a word. There were devout Jews out of every nation that was gathered together, which had different languages. Why did they have different languages? Because of the great dispersion. So when the power of the Holy Ghost came down in Joel chapter 2, which most people think when you're filled with the Holy Spirit, you have to speak in tongues, has nothing to do with it. What the Holy Spirit is going to do is empower you to testify or preach the gospel. And they heard the word, the gospel, in their own language.
Amen.
They was pricked in their heart, and they said, what the heck's going on? Peter, standing up, said, hey, this is what was spoken of, Old Covenant, in Joel chapter 2, that in the last days, that your sons and daughters would preach.
Yes.
What did you say? Oh, that, guess what? That qualifies you to be a preacher.
Amen.
What? Yes. Yes.
Amen.
Ananias and Sapphira, there was a church in the house of Chloe. What did you say? Oh, yeah. Sons and daughters. I'm sorry to rain on your theology, your theocracy. Okay? It's about being empowered. In fact, remember, we done went through this already. The first one that preached the gospel was Mary. This is the movie. He was dead, and he is alive again. He appeared to me. What, you don't believe me? He did appear to me, I tell you. What, because I'm a woman, he can't appear to me? She preached the gospel, he was dead, but he is alive again.
Hallelujah.
Thank you, Lord. He is alive.
Don't ever say that a woman can't preach the gospel.
That's right.
Amen.
Amen.
She
yelled. That was from Jesus in Nazareth. I know it was bad, but you know. I like to do. And after she said it, she kind of looked around to see what the people were looking like. They all like, right? Craziness. All right. You know what? For I live only to see his face.
Amen.
Stephen, through the power of the Holy Ghost in Acts chapter 7, and I'm going to run through these real quick. Before I run through these quick scriptures, you ain't got to turn to them. We're on YouTube. You go to the Citadel Church. If you miss any of the scriptures, you can just go to YouTube and watch it on YouTube. I'm going to run through some scriptures. I didn't pull them out randomly. I just kind of went through Acts. But what I want to do is, once I show you, and you really have a good understanding, which most of you already do, you know, I want you reading. You need to read. Please. For God's sake. Wow. You hear what I said? For God's. Most of you read for your sake. But it's not about your sake, because your sake is already sealed with Him. It's so that you can help others' sake.
Wow.
Sit down.
That's good.
Deep.
It's about others' sake.
So God can use you.
It's a wonderful reason.
Right, so others can use you. To help others. Remember, it's not about you. It's about others.
Yeah.
It's not about you. It's about others. And next Saturday, hold on, son. Because I'm going to take you for the rod. I'm going to take you for a rod. So that next week, when we start going where we're going, you're going to remember it. So that when you start talking to others, you too are going to start connecting dots for others. Because I'm going to show you Jesus all over the place. I'm going to show you Jesus. I'm going to show you Jesus. I'm going to show you Jesus. I'm going to show you Jesus before there was a Jesus. I'm going to show you a Jesus while there was a Jesus. And I'm going to show you Jesus when he returns, what's going to happen and what it's going to look like by the old scriptures. Old covenant. The old covenant. So that you can show others and, you know, watch their jaw fall down on a table, you know, and then when you're talking to them, they're kind of, my wife calls it, when me and my mama get together and start talking it, uh-huh. Talking, we're sitting at the table,
here comes.
We kind of lean toward
one another. They're doing the lean.
You know why? You know why we lean toward one another? Because Jesus said, the words that come out of my mouth is food and life.
Amen.
And when someone starts feeding, man, it's like, you gotta be really careful, because you might look like a what you call those big dogs with the big
Saint Bernard.
You have drool hanging all over you.
They lean over the plate.
Right, it may drip it off you. You know, they have already put rain jackets on in the front in church here. The women of the church, they all conspired together.
Huh? A woman.
Right? I walked out there and I'm about to minister, and all of them up on the front row, all the women are wearing a raincoat.
Ponchos.
I'm like, what's going on? Because the spit goes everywhere. And they put in earplugs. Listen, when the Holy Spirit comes, the whole house shakes. If this house ain't shaking, they ain't hear nothing out there.
Amen. Mm-hmm.
Right?
Uh-huh.
It's your house that should be shaking.
Yes.
All right. So next week, we're going to get into stuff. Check this out. I'm just going to run through. You ain't got to turn to them. Luke 1:15. John was filled with the Holy Ghost while he was yet in his mother's womb.
Yep.
And with the power of the Holy Ghost, he said, behold, the Lamb of God that takes away the sins of the world. The Holy Ghost, the Holy Spirit, is identifying Jesus. It says in Luke chapter 2, verse 25 and 26, it says, "And it was revealed unto him," watch this, "unto John the Baptist by the Holy Ghost, that he should not..." Zechariah. "And it was revealed unto him by the Holy Ghost that he should not see death before he had seen the Lord's Christ." You see? He's only there to do one thing. It was revealed to him by the Holy Spirit that he was to see his face. Right? When he was circumcised, 8 days old. "Behold, I can die now. I've seen his face." How did he get to see his face? The power of the Holy Ghost. Luke chapter 3, verse 21 and 22. "Now when all the people were baptized, it came to pass that also Jesus, being baptized and praying, the heaven was opened, and the Holy Ghost descended on him in the bodily shape of a dove." The dove, the Holy Spirit, rests on his head. Didn't rest on nobody else's head. And there were many people out there. Yeah. Right? And he said, "In the bodily shape of a dove, and a voice from heaven said, Thou art my beloved Son." Wow, in whom I am well pleased. So the Holy Spirit is the identifier of Jesus Christ. Jesus the Christ, the Messiah. That's what he's going to do and show you. Why? So you can show others. So that you can become a witness. So that you can become a testimony. But if you don't read, the Holy Spirit will show you nothing.
Amen.
He'll show you nothing.
Nothing.
Think about that. Because he only moves on the Word. The Spirit of God only moves on God's Word. Sorry. Luke chapter 4, verse 18. Jesus said, "The Holy Spirit," watch this, "the Holy Spirit is upon me." Okay, the Holy Spirit's on him. So let's see what he's going to do now. Because the Holy Spirit is the revealer of Jesus Christ. Now this is Jesus Christ saying, "The Holy Spirit is upon me. He hath anointed me to preach the gospel to the poor. He hath sent me to heal the brokenhearted." But I want you to take notice what the Holy Spirit's job is. Now Jesus is speaking through the Holy Spirit. He's anointed me to interpret the Word of God. That's what he says. Watch this. "To preach deliverance to the captives." Where does that go to? Where does that go to? Egypt. See? Watch this. "The recovering of the sight to the blind." Those that say they can see, their sins remain. Right? Right? If you couldn't see, your sins would be forgiven you. Right? The Pharisees and Sadducees, they had the law of God. Right? Show the knowledge of good and evil. Well, that's the same tree, the fig tree, that Adam and Eve ate from and opened their eyes to self. That's why Jesus said, if you were blind, well, then your sins would be forgiven you. Because if you're blind, you can't see what's wrong with somebody else.
Amen.
You won't pass them through the law.
Right.
You'll pass them through the olive tree, the tree of life, the tree of love. And you'll love them and not judge them.
Right.
But you see, the Pharisees and Sadducees were judges. They judged. He says, "Recovering sight to the blind, to set at liberty them that are bruised." And then he says something that is so absolutely mind-blowing that only the Messiah could say this, the Christ, the Anointed One, "to preach the Jubilee year of the Lord." The Jubilee year of the Lord. That's the acceptable year of the Lord. All debt, all sin, everything is forgiven. Now think about this. He's in the synagogue telling these people this. And when he's reading from the book of Isaiah 53. And that's okay. And they got it right there. Because they just enjoying the reading. Yep, one day our Messiah is going to come. And we all going to be set free. And then... And then he says something. But before he says it, he does something. You see, to go up there and stand behind a pulpit and read like this. And it just so happened to be... You see, because the Jews start in the Torah and they read the Torah, Genesis, Exodus, Leviticus, Numbers, and Deuteronomy, through the year. And they read half Torah, Psalms, and the Prophets. But they go from year to year. Okay? And then they start again new. Every Rosh Hashanah, which you're going to find out when they start reading again. Jesus walks in on the very day... on that appointed, what did you say? Well, appointed means moed, and moed means feast or festival. It was God's appointed time. What did you say? And then while he's standing there reading, and they're gonna roll the scroll back up, he does something that is so absolutely crazy.
Glory to God.
He does this. He does this right here. He doesn't leave. He sits down. Son, because when you sit down up there, it means you have something to say. And you know what that means? That means, hold on, people. You might want to take a seat. Because what I'm fixing to tell you is fixing to knock you down.
That's right. Hallelujah.
Remember when they came for Jesus in the garden?
Mm-hmm.
Who are you looking for in John? Jesus of Nazareth.
Yeah.
I am. What did you say? I am he. And they all fall down. They all fall down. They all fall down. They all fall down.
Yeah.
That was a good thing.
Amen.
I know I fell down when I saw him.
Yeah.
And so did Isaiah. And so did Moses. He was like this.
So did
and so did Abraham.
So did Joshua.
And so did Joshua. And so did any ever one that ever's got to see him. He sits down and tells them something that's so absolutely mind-blowing. And they all, like, now they're fastened on him. And he says,
today,
my brethren, this scripture is fulfilled.
Amen.
In your hearing.
Yep.
That took a second to soak in, because their mind had to process what he was actually saying. Did Joseph's son just say that he was the Messiah? The Son of God? The Christ? The Christos? And they looked at him. And they wanted to kill him.
That's right.
Amen. That's right.
They wanted to take him outside and stone him. But he just walked through the crowd and went to Galilee and began a ministry. Now, wait, hold a second. Hold on a second. Because the Spirit's job. Now, how did it start? And Jesus, being full of the Holy Spirit, just had said he was the Messiah. The Holy Spirit revealed to those people that he was the Messiah. Still not convinced? Let's see. Remember, the purpose of the Holy Spirit is to reveal who Jesus is so that he can make you a witness.
Amen.
And a testimony for him. In John chapter 14, verse 22, it says, and it's John chapter 14, verse 22 to 26, and I'm not going to read it from my Bible. You guys can read it. Judas says, "Lord, how will you manifest or reveal yourself to us?" Verse 26. Hold it! Judas said, "How will you manifest or reveal yourself to us?" Next verse. "And when the power of the Holy Ghost comes upon you." So wait, hold on a second. The question is, how are you going to reveal or manifest yourself? Jesus says, "When the power of the Holy Ghost comes upon you, he will teach you all things." It's the question. I mean, come on. What's his job? He will teach you all things. "For you will not need a teacher," meaning a Levite. You won't have to go to the Levitical priesthood. "For he will teach you all things. Study to show yourself approved unto God." Right? Here, check this one out. This is good. Here. Hey, you want to get really crazy? Let's get really crazy. Okay. Let's get really crazy.
Okay.
In the Bible, you can see God the Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. And these three are one. These three agree as one, right? There are three that bear witness in heaven, 1 John 5, and there are three that bear witness in the earth. The Spirit, the water, and the blood, and these three are agree as one. The Spirit, the Word, and the Father in heaven, and these three are one, right? Right? So, I told the Lord, "I see God the Father and the Son, but show me the person of the Holy Spirit in the Old Covenant." Right? Elijah and Elisha, God the Father and Son, you know, Moses and Joshua, all of this. But you know, the other thing is, I told you, Abraham and Isaac. Abraham the father, Isaac the son. Isaac's a picture of Christ, Abraham the father. Now he had a head servant, Eleazar. Remember that? Eleazar's name means helper. In Romans, the Bible says that the Holy Spirit is our helper. What is he helping us? And all kind of things, you know? But the Holy Spirit's job is to reveal the Son. So Eleazar went to get a bride, right?
Right.
So Eleazar goes, finds Rebecca, you know the story, and now Isaac is a picture of Jesus Christ. You know that, right?
Right. Mm-hmm.
So now, here it is, Rebecca's riding on a camel, coming back, and Eleazar, which is the Spirit, is walking, and they come into the field. And who's in the field?
Yeah.
Isaac.
Yeah.
And Rebecca says to Eleazar, "Who is that? Who is that?" And the Spirit says, "That is my master and my Lord, Isaac." He revealed to her who Isaac was, because that's his job.
That's right. And then she covered herself.
And then she covered herself. That's right. See that? You've been reading. Rebecca reads a lot. I get a ton from her. All right, let's see. What else we got? You guys all right? Your butts are hurting? Your butts are hurting? Are you still hungry?
Yeah.
I gave you some more.
Yeah.
Check this out. And Philip, in Acts chapter 8, being full of the Holy Ghost, it says, in Acts chapter 8, in verse 28 through verse 39, it says, "And Philip, the Ethiopian eunuch, was, you know, being carried, and the Ethiopian," it says, "and by the Holy Spirit, the Spirit told Philip to move close to the chariot." The Spirit told him.
Yes.
And when he moved close to the chariot, the Ethiopian was reading from Isaiah 53.
Yeah.
And he was listening. And now the Spirit told him, and he's walking on side of the chariot, and the Ethiopian, the rich Ethiopian eunuch, is reading from Isaiah. So Philip says to him, by the power of the Holy Ghost, "Hey, Bubba, you know what you're reading?" And he looks at him, he says, "Man, I'm going to know what I'm reading unless I have someone to teach me. And he said, Holt, stop. And he called him up on a chariot with him. And they start going down a road. And starting from Isaiah 53 in verse 8, Jesus being bruised for our iniquities, Philip, through the power of the Holy Ghost, begins to reveal to the Ethiopian eunuch who Jesus was and how he must die and how he would be raised again on the third day. And the eunuch believed in his heart and said, there is water. What does hinder me from taking part in the death, burial, and resurrection of Jesus Christ?
Amen.
He says, nothing. He said, well, stop. Because we're going to get this done now, son. And watch this. This is the first, well, one of the, not the first, but the first teleportation in the new covenant.
That's right.
Right? And Philip, they go down to the water and he baptizes him. And when the Ethiopian comes up out of the water, Philip is gone, son.
Yeah.
Right.
You know where he's at? He's in Caesarea. He's in Caesarea Philippi.
Translated.
It was translated because the Spirit had another job for him. Wow. But you see. You see?
Mm-hmm.
You see yet. You see the importance of knowing the Scriptures?
Yeah.
Right? Here, watch this one. This is good too. You okay, Noah? You okay?
He's putting his hand on.
Oh, why? I know. Paw preaches long.
Right here.
Paw preaches long. Watch this. You know, at least you guys will have these scriptures. I'm just about done. Let's see. Revelations chapter 1, verse 13 to 20. The Bible says, John was in the Spirit on the Lord's day when he received the revelation of Jesus Christ. Right? It was in the Spirit. The Holy Spirit's purpose is to reveal the Son. You know, 1 Peter 1. 1 Peter chapter 1, verse 7. I'm going to read that one. You guys can stay there. I'll get to it quick. 1 Peter 1. He says this. Remember, this letter is going out to the ones that was that Peter had preached to on the day of Pentecost. Look what he says in verse 7. He says... He says, verse 7, it says, that the trial of your faith, being much more precious than gold, that perisheth, though it be tried with fire, might be found unto praise and honor and glory at the appearing of the Lord Jesus Christ. Watch this. Whom, having not seen, ye love, in whom, though now you see him not, yet believing, ye rejoice with all joy unspeakable, being full of glory. And I missed that one. I'm sorry. I missed something on that. I didn't write something down. I'm sorry. Well, I guess what I was going to say is it was the power of the Holy Ghost. God used the Holy Spirit to reveal unto them the face of Jesus Christ, and that's what he was talking about there. Let's see. Now, here's one for you to think about. Now I'm going to get crazy with you. One for you to go out on. All right? I'm going to kind of flip some things around. How many of you guys know, and I'm just about finished, how many of you guys know the full armor of God? The full armor of God.
Ephesians 6.
Tell me what the full armor is, Jay.
The helmet of salvation, the breastplate of righteousness, the shield of faith, the sword of the Spirit, gird up your loins with the belt of truth, and shod your shoes with the gospel of peace.
That's it. Helmet of salvation. The only thing in the full armor of God in Ephesians chapter 6 that's offensive is the sword. Right? The Bible says the word of God is quick and powerful and sharper than any two-edged sword. Right? So, your helmet of salvation, right? Our breastplate of righteousness, the sword of the Spirit. Wow. Wait, hold on a second. Did you hear what I said?
Yeah.
What is the sword? The sword of the Spirit, which is the Word of God. So if it's the sword of the Spirit, can I just tell you this? It's if it's the sword of the Spirit, it's the sword of the Spirit. So that means this is the Spirit's sword.
Mm-hmm.
You with me?
Yeah.
That's right. It's his sword. This is what he uses. What did you say? What does the Spirit use?
The Word.
If you don't have the Word in you, what is he going to use? It's his sword. Do you know his sword? I guarantee it. He's the one that's most capable of teaching you and showing you how to use his sword, which is the Word of God.
Amen.
It's his.
Amen.
The sword of the Spirit, the Spirit's sword, which is the Word of God, that cuts and divides,
yes,
even unto the joints and the marrow, and is a discerner of the very intentions, right, of the heart. If you have his sword, if you have his word, that means through the power of the Holy Spirit, you can reach in there, son, and cut people and prick them in their heart by the word of God, by the Spirit's sword that he uses and just gets up in there when nobody else can get, and all of a sudden you're like, oh my God. You ever think about the scripture? Those who worship me will worship me in spirit. Wait, hold on a second now. I'm really like, wait. The Spirit's job is to do what? To reveal truth. What is truth?
God's word.
Jesus. That's right. Thy word is truth. Watch this now. So those that worship me will worship me in spirit. Now, what does that mean? The only way you can truly worship the Father in spirit is by the Spirit giving you a revelation of who Jesus Christ is. The truth of the word, which will cause you to hit your face. You realize? You cannot worship him any other way. You realize that? Think about the way worship is today. A true worshiper is one who has seen his face. Wow. I don't care how good your band is. I don't care what you do. I don't care what kind of parade you put on. You know somebody who's met him. You know it. Because they've seen him.
Yes.
They've been affected by him. They get consumed by him. And that's all they want is him. And you know what? That's all they talk about. Man. I can't help it. I know. I'm long-winded.
No.
Can I add to that?
Yes, go ahead.
I went back and read Ephesians 6 when it starts out, and all it did was connect me back to Exodus when God told Moses, you should have taken of the lamb with what? Your loins girded.
That's right. Which
watch.
Is?
And he says, your staff in your hand. And he says, and your sandal on your feet.
That's
gives an order.
That's right.
Watch this, Ephesians chapter 6. Stand for having your loins girded.
That's right.
Taking the Passover lamb. About your loins girded with the belt of truth.
Wow.
The breastplate of righteousness and shod your shoes.
That's right. That's
the
right.
The same order he gave you in Exodus.
But and you know what's in Exodus? Because they hadn't yet come through the Red Sea yet. So they wouldn't have the helmet of salvation on them yet or the breastplate of righteousness because they haven't come through the Red Sea. Anyway, I'm going to close with this. Hey, you know what's amazing? That's where we're going next week. Exodus chapter 1. Wow. Listen to this. The purpose for reading, I'm done. The purpose for reading and studying the Word is so that you can become a witness and be able to prove through the Word and by the Word, through the Holy Spirit, by the Holy Spirit, that Jesus is the Savior of the world. Having the ability to be able to open your Bible and show them. Wow. Or just talk.
Yeah.
Having being full of the Spirit. You don't have to know where it's at in Scripture and in the verse. In Acts chapter 13, verse 14 through 50, Paul preaches on the first Sabbath, and he starts by starting them out at Egypt and brings them all the way to the cross. See how he does, how he proves it? Let everything be established by two or three witnesses, the Bible says. The old covenant is one witness. The new covenant is the second witness, and you are the third witness. In John chapter 5, verse 39 through 47, you know, Jesus says, "Search the Scriptures, for in them they testify of me."
Amen.
Let's pray. Yes, Rebecca, before we pray.
Hey,
come on.
It's a little long, but can you please read John 17? This is...
John.
This is Jesus' prayer to his Father right before he's arrested.
I can do that.
Not only does he pray for his disciples, but he also prays for anyone who believes in him.
Right. Let's read it. You ready?
It is so intimate. It shows you how true, how much love he actually had
for people.
He prays for those who are going to be one by the disciples.
Yeah, but what was so amazing to me, and it really, I cried when I read this.
I did too. When God opened it up, I just cried.
I know. I did a big study with this right here, man. This was amazing.
And he looked up to the Father to pray. This man knew he was about to die. He knew what he was about to do.
Right.
For us. He didn't even know us.
What's up, George?
Okay, I got a question.
Yes.
While I was going through a reading Bible program, if you come to Ezekiel 1, is this Jesus is talking about?
In Ezekiel 1?
Yeah.
I'd have to go look.
It says the word Lord came to Ezekiel 3. The son of, I can't pronounce the name, in the land of Chaldeans by the river, and the hand of the Lord was upon him, and I looked and beheld a whirlwind came out of the north, a great cloud, and a fire enfolding itself, and a brightness was about it, and out of the midst thereof, as the color of amber, out of the midst of the fire.
Yeah.
And also out of the midst thereof came the likeness of four living creatures.
Yeah.
And this was their appearance, and they had the likeness of a man.
Yeah, absolutely. That's the cherubim that was actually called, that was carrying him. The Bible says he rode upon the wings of the cherubim, and his throne is encompassed with green, with emerald. Yeah. Yeah, that was definitely him, for sure. Let's read this. These words spake Jesus and lifted up his eyes to heaven and said, Father, the hour is come. Glorify thy Son, that thy Son also may glorify thee. As thou hast given him power over all flesh, that he should give eternal life to as many as thou hast given him. I want to tell you something. So you can just calm down for a second. The Bible says, let the prophet speak two or three and let the others judge. Okay? It's important to listen to what it is that the Spirit says. So if the Spirit wants us to read something and we think it's time to go, well then it might be for that person. We're always in a rush to get out of here and go. You know, and this isn't something they did in the Old Covenant. In Christ, the Sabbath was sat down. They fellowshiped all day. They stayed together. You know, and if you have to go, it's good. It's okay. It's fine. Nobody will judge you here, I guarantee it. But, you know, so it's important to hear what others, you know, some, one brings a psalm, one brings a hymn, one brings a word.
Yeah.
Let the prophet speak two or three, let the others judge, meaning is a word from the Lord or not. So let's see what the Lord is saying here. This might be the very word that you need. These words spake Jesus as he lifted up his eyes to heaven and said, Father, the hour is come. Glorify thy Son, that thy Son also may glorify thee. As thou hast given him power over all flesh, that he should give eternal life to as many as thou hast given him. And this is life eternal, that they might know thee, the only true God, and Jesus Christ, whom thou hast sent. I have glorified thee on the earth. Meaning, that word glorify means to reveal his face. That's what glorify means, to give glory. That's what it means. I have finished the work which thou hast given me to do. And now, O Father, glorify thou me with thine own self, with the glory which I had with thee before the world was. He's saying, Father, now reveal unto them who I really am, and reveal my face to him. That's what he's doing. I have manifested thy name unto men, which thou gavest me out of the world. Thine they were, they was his, and thou gavest them to me, and they have kept thy word. Now they have known that all things whatsoever thou hast given me are from you. For I have given unto them the words which thou gavest me, and they have received them, and have known surely that I came out from thee, and they have believed that thou didst send me. I pray for them. I pray not for the world, but for them, which thou hast given me, for they are yours. And all mine are yours. And thine are mine, and I am glorified in them, meaning I am revealed through them and by them. Just as Jesus revealed the Father, we reveal the Son. Mm-hmm. Right? And now I am no more in the world, but these are in the world, and I come to thee, Holy Father. Keep through thine own name those whom thou hast given me, that they may be one as we are. What are they? They're one. While I was with them in the world, I kept them in thy name. In the word, right? He kept them. Those that thou gavest me, I have kept, and none of them is lost but the son of perdition, that the scriptures might be fulfilled. And now come I to thee, and these things I speak in the world, that they might have joy fulfilled in themselves. Wow. So knowing Jesus is unspeakable joy.
Amen.
So if something happens to us, we go to be with the Father. That's peace that surpasses all understanding. That's what enables us to live or die, like Paul said. I have given them thy word, and the world hath hated them, because they are not of the world, even as I am not of the world. I pray not that thou shouldest take them out of the world, but that thou should keepest them from evil. Protect them from evil, right? So we have a job to do, you know? You don't want to be like, you know, how you doing, brother? I'm just holding on till Jesus comes. Well, I tell you what, just keep holding on. Just keep holding on. Come on, man. Sanctify them. That means set them apart. Through thy truth. Wow. Thy word is truth. How do you set them apart? Oh, you could pick somebody out who's been with the word. God will sanctify them and set them apart, and you'll know it, just like Peter did. He knew that Jason and Pete was set apart, was sanctified because of the word, because of the ministry. It was different than what he was normally hearing. as though as thou hast sent me into the world, even so have I also sent them into the world. And for their sakes, I sanctify myself. Meaning I'm going. For their sake. Why? Let's see why. And for their sakes, I sanctify myself, that they also might be sanctified through thy truth. How? By him leaving, the Holy Spirit will empower them to become like he was. Wow. To reveal truth. Neither pray I for these alone, but for them also which shall believe on me through their word. Right? Through their message. How do people believe? Through the word. That they all may be one, as thou, Father, art in me, and I in thee, that they also may be one in us, that the world may believe that thou hast sent me. And the glory which thou hast gavest me, I have now given to them, that they may be one, even as we are one. I in them, and thou in me, that they may be made perfect in one, and that the world may know that thou hast sent me, and hast loved them, and thou hast loved me. Now wait a whole second. You know what that means? Let me just give you a really brief explanation. You can't have the old covenant without the new. You can't kick out 39 books of the Old Testament and say, I have Jesus. Well, you just kicked out the first witness. You have to know it. The Father in the Old Covenant spoke of the Son. New Covenant, all he does is speaks of the Father. And these two agree as one. Father, verse 24, I will that they also, whom thou hast given me, be with me where I am. He's talking about you. You know that, right? This is about you. Father, I will that they also, whom thou gavest me, have given to me, be with me where I am, that they may behold my face. You just put glory. It says glory, but you just put face right there, because that's what it means. Which thou hast given me, and thou lovest me before the foundation of the world. O righteous Father, the world hath not known thee, but I have known thee, and these have known that thou hast sent me. And I have declared unto them thy name. You know what the name of God is? Salvation. He's the God of salvation. Yeshua, Yahweh, Yod-Heh-Vav-Heh. It's the name. It's the name of salvation. And I have declared unto them thy name, and I will declare it, that the love wherewith thou hast loved me may be in them, and I in them. And then he's arrested.
Amen.
Let's pray. Do you realize that we just, you know, got into the word of truth, and that prayer that Jesus prayed 2,000 years ago was just delivered to us by the power of the Holy Spirit. Wow, I just got it. I just got it. Before we left today, the Lord wanted us to know that he's praying for you and me. He was here. He loves us. He wants us to be empowered. He just let us know that we're his. Wow, thank you.
Amen.
Let's pray. Father, you are amazing, Lord.
Yes.
Yes. Oh, yeah. Father, you are amazing. Father, we thank you. First, Lord, for your love for us. We thank you, Father, that you was here with us today. We thank you for the word that came forth at the end, that your son is up there right now. He's thinking about us, about our little church, our little gathering. Wow. Because you spoke that to us through the Word, by the unction of the Holy Spirit, you wanted us to know how you felt about us, Lord. And we receive it today, Lord. We thank you for your love.
Thank you, Lord.
We thank you for your Word that you've given us.
Thank you.
We thank you that we know that you're praying for us.
Yes.
And that you called us. And that you've set us apart to show forth your glory, the face of Jesus. Lord, I lift up, you're the high priest, and I lift up all of us that are here. Help us, Lord. Give us a desire by your Holy Spirit to want to read and study your Word. Help us, Lord. You helped me. I couldn't do it. We can't do it on our own. Lord, one, give us a desire by your Spirit to search you out so that we can be a witness and a testimony for you. Father, I thank you, Lord, that the people that are here that you brought, Lord, Lord, you just thank you, Father.
Thank you, Lord.
Lord, I thank you, Father. I thank you, Lord, that you're working on our children.
Yes.
You know, I thank you, Father, that we can rest in you. And we know, Father, that you could save our household.
Yes.
So we lift up our children to you.
Yes.
And you know who they are. We're right here. We lift our children up to you. Everybody that's in here, our children,
yes,
we lift them up to you. You know all of our children.
Yes.
Lord, I ask that you would send your Holy Spirit to move over them right now, Father, in a great and mighty way. Lord, we ask for, Lord, a testimony and a witness to their lives being changed, Lord. Your Spirit brings conviction. Your Spirit is it's you, Father.
Yes.
Woo them by your love.
Yes.
Lord, I ask, Father, that you would protect them,
yes,
while they're in the world. Lord, even as you protected me,
yes,
when I deserved to die, Lord, when I was a sinner, Father, just, you loved me. Loved me in my mess.
Mm-hmm.
Lord, you are more powerful than any sin, than any mess. I thank you for your Son, Jesus. And you're the one that I come to, and I ask, not only for our children, but for us, Lord. We're all your children. Lord, send your Spirit to help us to be what it is that you've called us to be. Forgive us, Lord, and cleanse us. Lord, help us to be a witness and a testimony for you no matter where we go, Father. We love you. We thank you for your love. We thank you for your Word. We thank you for your Son, Jesus. We thank you, Father, for your Holy Spirit who leads us and guides us in this wicked world. We thank you that he gives us the revelation and the understanding of your Word. And Lord, we thank you that he's the one that will empower us as to what it is that we need in the days that are approaching. So we lift them all up to you, family, friends, loved ones. It's your body, Father. In Jesus' name, amen.
Amen.
Amen.